الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله الحمد لله all praise belongs to Allah سبحانه وتعالى for granting us once more the opportunity to continue discussing this great dua, dua makarim akhlaq, which is dua number 20 in Sahifa Sajjadiyya. It is altogether 30 passages, and we have will be discussing inshallah today passage number 25 and 26. That means after today we'll have four passages to go, but inshallah we'll continue discussing these sessions till 29th of Ramadan, which is expected to be the last day of Ramadan, most probably. That we are expecting the Eid to be on Sunday, on 1st of Shawwal. In any case, let's continue. Bismillah ar-Rahman Imam continue by saying, Allahumma fatlibni bi kudratika ma atlubu, wa ajirni bi izzatika mimma arhabu. Allahumma salli ala Nuwari. Subhanallah, this is passage number 25, is the shortest passage containing only one sentence, you can see. But interestingly, because it talks about the Qudrat and Izzat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma fatlibni bi kudratika ma'atlub. O Allah, bestow upon me what I seek through your power, the Qudrat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa ajirni bi izzatika mimma arhab. And grant me the sanctuary from what I fear through your might. So, this is ajirni, as you know, because ajir min an-nar, ya Rabb, the mujib is right, that O Allah, protect me or grant me sanctuary. You know? Izzatika mimma arhabu, no? That from your izzat to what I fear. Qudrat and izzat of Allah is mentioned in the Quran number of times. We will not be discussing detail because I'm sure that those who read Quran come across this, no? Innaka innahu ala kulli shay'in qadir, innaka ala shay'in qadir, inna Allah ala kulli shay'in qadir. This comes in Quran number of times. In fact, when I was preparing for this presentation, I had a quick look at the word Qudrat in its all different forms, no? From different forms in Arabic, Qadir, Qadir, no? Yaqdiru, all this form comes 130 times in the Quran, about 130 times. And Izzat Aziz, right? Allah is Aziz, comes 120 times. So you can just see, of course, in different forms. Sometimes it refers to Allah, sometimes, for example, we say, Al-Izzatillahi, right? Allah says that Izzat dignity is for believers. So that Izzat, although it's there in Quran, but it refers to the believers. But just good idea that how, you know, widespread these terminologies are spread coming, and especially meaning the Qudrat of Allah, power of Allah, and the might of Allah. You know? But you'll find that, you know, so often Allah, although is mighty, but just to, because you can imagine might. If somebody is mighty, then if some is mighty, if some power is mighty, if some country is mighty, right? If Allah is mighty, then there is no comparison, because you can never compare the Khaliq with Makhluk, right? But Allah, just to assure us, when he talks about is Aziz, that Allah Aziz, he will also add something, Aziz al-Ghafur, Aziz al-Rahim, right? So for example, Yasin al-Quran akim innaka ala min al-Muslim, Allah surat al-Mustaqim, tanzil al-Aziz al-Rahim, right? You can see, he said, tanzil al-Aziz al-Rahim. That this Quran is a descent, Tanzil al-Aziz, from Almighty, but He's also merciful. So you'll find that this comes in the Quran, that because when somebody who realizes how great Allah is, and then talks about Allah is Aziz, but immediately Allah says, no, Allah is Aziz, and all the same time, He's also merciful, right? But here Imam says that, Ya Allah, I should ask, allow me to seek through your power. Now, that means if I seek through Allah's power, then there's nothing else will come in the way. And protect me through your izzat, your might, from what I fear, right? So yes, I fear so many things. Just now people fear corona, that for example, you know, the Eid is coming, right? We are going to definitely meet our families, you know, sometimes far, sometimes near. I'm sure my grandchildren also who are in town, definitely come and meet us. There's no doubt in it. So now there'll be fear, should I hug them or not? No. What will happen, right? There's always that fear. But for example, here Imam is telling us, "Wa ajirni izzatika mimma harbu." Oh Allah, protect me keep me in your sanctuary, right? Protect me, bi-izzatika, through your might, mimma arhabu, from what I fear. So keep in mind that, yes, when a person has that kind of relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that, he builds that only through the qudrat of Allah, he will ask, and from the might of Allah, he will seek protection, then it gives him or her that kind of confidence that, since Allah has asked me to dua and I'm asking for these things. So Imam is teaching us, and no wonder that those who put these numbers, because I don't think this numbering of passages, which we find today in this dua, Makan al-Akhlaq, and Saif al-Zadiyah, I have some very old scriptures, about maybe 800 years, 9 years old in my library. It did not contain this numbering. So this numbering was done later on by some editors, But no wonder that whoever has put this numbering has decided to just put, consider this line only as a passage on its own. Perhaps because it talks about the qudrat of Allah and the might of Allah. The next passage, 26, Imam says, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali, Allah bless Muhammad and his family. Wasun wajhi bil yasari, wa la taqtaz al jahi bil iftikar. Astarziku ahad al-risk. Subhanallah. Now Imam is talking about honor and dignity, especially of a believer, mu'mineen, because I'm talking just not to believers. Keep one thing in mind that whoever you may be a rich person, you may be a poor person, you may be an influential person, you may be an ordinary person, right? You may be a senior, you may be a young, right? But because you are a mu'min, because you are a believer of Prophet and his Ahlul Bayt, there is a special izzat you have. And don't try to give away that izzat. You can see person like Imam saying, wasun wajhi bil yasar. Oh Allah, save my face through ease. Usually, we don't want ease, but sometimes, because if just to go and seek our risk, to go and work, if I have to become dhalil, if my boss or my employer or somebody who is my supervisor is always trying to put me down, no, we will not know. You can see, wasun wajhi bil yasar. Just save my face, that means save my izzat, dignity, through ease. Now, wala tabdhil jahi bil iftikar, fastarzika ahad risk, right? It says that, subhanAllah, and demean not my dignity through neediness. Now, iftikar is faqr, right? Iftikar, that means iftikar is a person, because he is just has less money, because he's less affluent, let that not be the cause for me to be demeaned, that I lose my izzat because of that. It's very important. And then, subhanAllah, Imam continues by, I can see a beautiful, wasta'tiya shirara khalkika, right? SubhanAllah, wasta'tiya shirara khalkika faftanina bihamdika man a'tani. Imam says that, just lest I seek provision from those whom you have provided, Al-Kika, whom you have provided, and then since you have provided, and ask for bestowal from the worst of your creatures, those who are worst of your creatures, that I should to go and ask them, because he says, then I said, I would be tried by praising him who gave to me and afflicted with blaming him who held back from me, while you are not there, are the pattern of giving and holding there, right? SubhanAllah. Anta min dunihim waliyul ata wal mana. Anta min dunihim, that you Allah besides them. Anta min dunihim besides them. Waliyul, that means actually master of al ata wal mana. To give and to take is Allah's power. Nobody else, especially risk. Nobody is any kind of your boss, your employer, your country. Nobody is right, because the fact that Allah has given us this. Creation. Allah has created us, has brought on this world. He also has provided our risk. Every child comes with a risk. Keep in mind. And the symbolic way is, for example, when a mother gives birth to a child, automatically you can see the first thing the child is going to consume is the milk, right? The breast milk. And that breast is filled with milk. It comes with it. It's so symbolic, right? It's not only at the time that we are just breastfeeding. That means the way, for example, a child comes, when a mother is given that milk to her breast so that she feeds the child, that process continues throughout the life. That means, yes, a time would come that my mother will wean me out, and after 2 years I'll stop, for example, breastfeeding. The risk of Allah will continue coming. So it's a beautiful, you can see, that's why I'm saying there's in this dua, there are certain principles, philosophical principles, which are hidden there. Now, like yesterday we heard that Imam was trying to say that, no, I should have ease in earning so that it should not distract me in ibadah. That was a really punchline. Today again, Imam says, "Anta min dunihim waliyul ata wal mana." Why should I go to a human being who should give me? Why should my boss or my employer or somebody else deprive me? Yes, Allah, you have the right to deprive me, because I know that your deprival also has a wisdom. That is why. When Allah deprives of me, I know for sure that there is some wisdom in it, right? So it's a beautiful passage, right? When it comes to Qudrat, I was just able to get one hadith, a beautiful hadith. Imam Ali says, "Oh Allah, how great is that which we see of your creation, yet how small its greatness is next to what is hidden from us of your Qudrat," right? So although even what we see is so, it seems to us go great. No, somebody had sent me a clip, because nowadays, not because of WhatsApp, you get so many clips, especially in the month of Ramadan. I don't even know why people have to send clips in the month of Ramadan. But somebody sent me a clip, and then it was talking about the universe, how huge and how great the universe is, right? So Imam says, how great is that universe? Because compared to this universe, our world is just a tiny thing, honestly. This, our world, although so huge it is, it takes 7 billion people, but still is tiny compared to the entire galaxy, right? So how great is that which we see of your creation? Yet how small its greatness is next to what is hidden from us of your Qudrat, subhanAllah. So here is Ali who's talking about the Qudrat of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And there is the Qudrat. Imam says, Allahumma fa'atlimi bi kudratika ma'atlimu, no? That, Ya Allah, just let me seek, no, through your power. Grant me the ability. Continuing, Ayatollah Mis Bazedi says that there is a similar expression, what you find in this passage, also in Nahj Balagha. Then he says the good thing, says, all masumin are of the same light, nur, and it is not surprising if supplication can be not traced to more than one of them. So keep that in mind. And then he, later on he says, of course, everyone prefers being respected, treated with honor and not with contempt. So keep, see what he says, Ayatollah Mis Bazedi. Quite interesting. If the visage, the way your appearance, clothing, behavior, attitude, and valuable works of a person are praised by others, he is respected in society. Otherwise, he is held in contempt and no one respects him. What he's trying to say is that sometimes people who have the ability to dress well, who can afford to keep themselves well, even then they just go to the in the presence of people just not wearing well and then losing the respect. That's not the correct thing. It's very important. We have, for example, I've seen a number of times when I was in the Hausa, when we'll go and meet our teachers at an odd time, right? But because we go and meet him, they would dress themselves well. They're at home with their family, right? They could just be wearing, you know, they will just, especially because somebody's coming or we go and meet, you'll see, although we are students, but because an outsider comes, they will dress with their own mama and clothing. So it's important that, you know, we should be presentable in the presence of people, that respect is maintained. Remember, I told you the respect for women is very important. Coming to this iftikar, you know, that for example, we should not ask. It's not only that we should not ask for keeping our dignity, but also reverse is true. That to keep or to maintain our dignity, we should never extend our hand, but at the same time, do not allow others to extend the hand when you know that there are signs that they need. So there's a beautiful verse in the Quran, subhanAllah, and I will admit today that I have read this ayat number of times, but I never knew, you know, how much deep that verse was until when I was preparing for this passage. Imagine, this is the beauty of the Quran. Now, so this is just a part of the verse. We said, يَحْسَبُهُمْ الْجَاهِلُ أَغْنِيَاءَ مِنَ التَّعْفُفِ نَتَعْرِفُهُمْ. He says that there are people who are so poor, referring to Ashab al-Sufa. If you just check what is Ashab al-Sufa, these were people who were completely downtrodden, poor people who had moved from Makkah to Medina, but they had nothing, no shelter, no family, you know, these are single people, right? So they used to just live in a platform. Even if you go today to Medina, May Allah give us that ability, inshallah, to go back to Medina. You'll find that just behind the Rosa of Rasulullah on the backside, there is that white, you know, what raised platform. That's where Ashab al-Sufa used to live. You know, you can see. So these people were so poor. The unaware considered them to be wealthy. Yahsubum al-Jahil Agniya. People who had no idea, when they look at them, they thought that they were what? Rich. Because of the restraint from begging. You see, Afif is somebody who is chaste. You know, for example, a woman who is chaste is known as Afifa, right? Afifa is a woman who maintains her chastity, right? So, minatafuf, subhanAllah, you can imagine they were so poor, so downtrodden, but their dignity was such that even others, when they saw at them, look at them, they thought they were rich. Quran is telling us, not anybody else. It's not Hadith, Quran is telling us. Yahsubum al-jahilu, jahilu agniya minatafufi. No, ta'rifuhum bisimam. You can only know them through their signs. You can recognize them through their contentment, countenance, the fitwa poor, right? La yasaluna nasa ilhafa. They would not ask, they would not beg people persistently or even at all. Subhanallah. Do you see? So when we are saying that, you know, we should maintain our dignity in not asking people, also the reverse is true. That if you know that somebody is suffering, somebody is in need, don't wait until he or she asks. No, just offer. Just in, no. If a person is as honest, will say, no, I don't need it. No, but the fact that you offer and they take, that means no, they were in need of it. No, so it's very important. It's an aspect I read this ayat so many times in Surah Al-Baqarah, right? We read Surah Al-Baqarah so many times, but I never realized. I would say that such depth. No, Quran, Subhanallah, is talking about even those people. Who are need, no? You can see in ta'rifuhum bisimahum. You can only know through a countenance. If you just look very close, you realize these people are need, no? La yas'aluna. They don't ask. Annas, people, ilhafan. Just no, they would not ask persistently or at all. Sometimes, for example, they'll ask only once, but then they'll not ask again, right? This was the respect, Ashab al-Sufa. If you just go. But Rasulullah used to go and sit with them and talk to them, subhanAllah, so much so that people objected that you are befriending the poor. And Prophet said, yes, I take pride in befriending the poor. You can imagine. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq that we do that. No? A beautiful hadith from Imam Sajjad, he says, he who does not see what he says, subhanAllah. Again, the same Imam whose dua we are doing, he says, man lam yarij nasa, no, fi shayin, وَرَدَّ أَمْرُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ فِي جَمِيعُ أُمُورِهِ إِسْتَجَابُ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ لَهُ فِي كُلِّ شَيْءٍ SubhanAllah. He who does not place his hope in people for anything and refers his matters, all matters, كُلُّ أَمْرٍ. He refers all his matters instead to Allah. Allah the Mighty and Exalted will grant his need. So do you see this thing? That whenever we are in a problem, however small or big is, make sure that we first refer to Allah. As far as, excuse me, this little took longer, but it's a beautiful passage, and I thought that I should give the message, the deep message of this passage. We go to what, as far as what, yeah, as far as the tea for Ramadan is concerned, we continue discussion what we started yesterday. Mu'mineen, let us do a lot of tilawa in Ramadan, right? The hadith says, لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ رَبِيٌّ وَرَبِيُّ الْقُرْآنِ Ramadan, right? For everything there is a spring, and the spring of Ramadan is, the spring of Quran is Ramadan, right? So let us make this to be a spring of Quran. Let us really, a spring is so important that in some countries you get a break during spring, right? That 1 week. Go and enjoy the spring. Go and see the beauty. Which is, you know, flowers are starting coming out. You find the trees which had lost, you know, leaves are coming up, right? So make this a spring. No? In fact, the Hadith Al-Kafi says, Suf Ibrahim was revealed on the first night of Ramadan, right? You're saying, Suf Ibrahim or Musa, Surah Allah, there's a mention of Suf Ibrahim. Suf means scroll. Torah was revealed after passing 6 nights of Ramadan. Injil was revealed on the 13th night of Ramadan. Zabur was revealed on the 18th night of Ramadan. The Quran, we are told, was revealed on the 100th night of Qadr or 23rd night of Ramadan, right? So you can see all the scriptures were revealed in the month of Ramadan. So Ramadan has that affinity when it comes to holy book, scriptures. And let us make this to be the month of Ramadan, month of Quran, right? Imam Sadiq al-Islam has said that nothing upsets our sworn enemy, Iblis and his army, like the recitation of Quran. Mu'mineen, I can assure you, you try this thing. Let me give you a small homework. I've not given you since we've started. Just now I can see there are 112 people attending this session. Some of you already have formed the habit of reciting Quran every day in Ramadan. For example, one sipara, half a sipara. But those who are not, right? Just from today, today is Monday, right? Till, for example, Saturday is the last day of Ramadan. So you just say that I'm going to recite certain amount of the Quran. Say one sipara, half a sipara, two-thirds, whatever. Just do the niyat today. And by Saturday, you'll come back to me and tell me, I can assure you, take from me, this is a guarantee, that you just plant this thing and you will see so many obstacles coming. In your plan of reciting certain passage of Quran, certain section, one sipara, half a sipara, two siparas, as you plan, you try, but you'll see as you sit to do this thing, so many things will come in the way, obstacles. Shaitan does not like, it's obsessed the enemy, He would never like you to recite Quran, Imam says, and try this thing, you'll find it will come. The prophets advise us to enlighten our houses through tilawat of Quran, right? So enlighten our house, and what can be a better month than Ramadan to enlighten? This is month of spiritual, right? And that the rust that gathers on our hearts can be removed by station. We have fasted, obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So physically our body has received all those kind of benefits of fasting, right? Now there is the rust also on our heart, right? That has to be removed through reciting of Quran. We have done everything, for example, through fasting. Our body has, for example, our hands have fasted, our tongues have fasted, our belly has fasted, right? Now the heart also had carried rust all this year, throughout the year. Let us remove it through reciting Quran. No? Tomorrow, inshallah, if Allah gives us tawfiq, we'll discuss about a very important question which comes again and again, that why should we recite something we don't understand? Why should we do tilawat in Arabic when that's not our mother tongue, inshallah? Any questions, any complications for today?
Yes, assalamu alaikum. Is there any recommendation for Shawwal fasting starting from second Shawwal? Six fasts or so?
Yes. The Sunnis have a very strong belief in that you send off Ramadan by fasting for 6 days. We have a similar hadith, but it's not that strong. Some of the scholars say, yes, it's there. Some of the scholars say that, it's not that strong. So there's nothing wrong in it. No. But keep in mind that fasting on Thursday and if Monday is recommended in any case, right? So if nothing, then at least, for example, the Eid is on. Now, of course, keep in mind that Eid is on Sunday. Don't fast on Monday, right? Because, of course, this day is because of just now isolation, maybe it's okay. Otherwise, it's good that not to have Eid and then be with the family and extended family for 1 or 2 days. So in this case, maybe perhaps start on Thursday. No, you can do a fast on Thursday. But yeah, fasting 6 days to send off Ramadan is a strong belief with Sunnis. With Shia, there are some hadiths, but not very strong.
Good question. Thank you. If you have other questions, just come off mute and feel free, or you can use the chat. There is one question, a couple of questions in the chat. Suhuf Ibrahim, can you provide more details on that?
Yes, there. So if you see this Surat Al-A'la, in Nadalika fi Suhuf Ibrahim Musa. Now, Suhuf is that, these are scrolls, right? So, for example, we say Sahifa. Just now, Sahifa is a singular, Suhuf is a scroll, right? So Ibrahim also received some. You should know that although when you went to Madrasa, you were told there were only 4 books. No, there were 104 books which were revealed by Allah. Not 4 books, 4. But 4 are the scriptures which we know of complete. Other prophets just received suf, that means just parchments or scrolls. No, and those are together 100. So Ibrahim also received suf. And that also was revealed on the first night of Ramadan.
Okay, good. Another question is there any specific amal for the 25th, 27th, and 29th night of Ramadan?
Okay, I don't remember often. I'll check it if there's any special thing in the books. Mafati might have it. I have my Mafati with me. Let me see if I can quickly get it. But otherwise, you know, of course, as we said, they try to use your time. Let me see if it shows here any kind of special interest. Yes, the night of Qadr, and after night of Qadr, the 23rd night of Ramadan. After 27th night of Ramadan, they say, Lusted also asked somebody, you know, they say the 27th night of Ramadan, Mafati says, Bath Ghusl is recommended. It is reported that Imam Zain al-Abidin used to recite the following supplication repeated on this night. It's the short dua, Allahumma rzuqni at-tajafi an dar al-ghurur. والإنابة إلى دار الخلود والاستعداد للموت قبل الحلول. So just a short dua. Oh Allah, enable me to detach myself from this abode of illusion and to turn to the abode of permanent. Enable me to prepare myself for the death before it is too late. So it's a short dua, inshallah. Tomorrow, if I remember, I will put on the slide so Mumin can benefit. So that is the only thing that disappears. Then the last night of Ramadan, we'll discuss about it. Last night of Ramadan is very important. There's a discussion on its own, which we'll carry, inshallah, in this Ramadan trips. We'll discuss about it.
Very good. A few more questions here. The Suhuf Ibrahim remained with which home, which people?
Nabi Ibrahim, right? People who had Namrud, and because, you know, Ibrahim, as you know, Quran has mentioned about Nabi Ibrahim in detail. Subhanallah, Nabi Ibrahim is considered as a patriarch of Christianity, of Judaism and Islam. So people who was preaching. If you just look at, just isolate the verses of Quran, Nabi Ibrahim, you'll be surprised. It's rich on that, no? So, of course, his own people, when he was preaching with them, Ibrahim, of course, and had then he was considered as a champion of Tawheed, right? During his time, there was so much idol worshipping, and his own uncle, Azar, right? He had to argue with him. Such that even they wanted to burn him, right? Because he broke that idol, and then they threw him in the fire. But Allah is the one who saved him. So just look at the stories around Nabi Ibrahim. So of course he also received some suhuf from Allah Subhanahu wa Taala.
Thank you. Question about the revelation of the Quran. What is the difference between anzalna and tanzil? And when was the first verse, Iqra, revealed?
Okay, there's a long answer to that. It's not a small thing which can be said, but Tanzil and Zal, one is that, for example, gradual descent, and that's what Quran came, as far as Quran is concerned, you know, it came in both the form. For example, you can see, Inna anzalnahu fi al-Qadr, that means the whole Quran was revealed to the heart of the Prophet, right? Or some say from, you know, Baytul Ma'mur, for example, from Allah to Baytul Ma'mur. So that is Anzalna. But then Tanzil is graduation. So Quran then came to the Prophet also in stages. Jibreel brought in different occasions, as Quran is telling us. But at the same time, Quran also came at a go to the heart of the Prophet. So both revelation is there. But compared to Quran, other books were revealed at a go. For example, the whole Torah came on the sixth night after in Ramadan, right? Entire Injil came on the 13th night of Ramadan. Entire Zabur came on the 18th night of Ramadan, right? 18th of Ramadan. So entire Suf Ibrahim was on the first night of Ramadan. But Quran came both on the night of Qadr, you know, and at the same time also it came in stages. And of course, first five verses of Surah number 6, Surah Al-Alaq, was the first to be revealed. Iqra, no, Rabbikal Khalaq, these were five verses of the first one to be revealed.
Excellent. One clarification on the current slide. The questioner is asking that he's heard that Prophet Musa went to Mount Sinai on the 1st of Zilqad to 10th of Zilqad to the 10th of Zilhajj for 40 days, and that is when Torah was revealed. Was the Torah revealed in Ramadan or in Zilhajj?
Yeah, that's a good observation, and I appreciate that. No, you see, certain things appear, it seems to us that there is some conflict, but could be that maybe what was revealed by about Zilkad in those 10 days, keep in mind that that was just a tablet he received. Doesn't mean that the whole Torah, no? Could be. But yeah, one has to do some, these are the things which is not a simple answer. One has to do a deep study. You know, the fact that this hadith appears in Kafi, and I remember, if I'm not mistaken, even Allama Tabatabai has quoted this hadith. So a person like Tabatabai, who is such a great scholar, would not just pick up any hadith. You know, usually when I find a hadith which appears in Al-Mizan, I don't even bother to go back to look at it because I know he was such a great scholar. So you have to actually do some research to reconcile that aspect of, you know, Zabur being, for example, Torah revealing Ramadan and those 10 days in, because he was asked to go and an appointment with Allah for 30 days, right? And that was 30 days of Zilkar. And then the 10 days were added, which was the days of Zilhajj. At that time, he received the tablet. Now, is the tablet part of the whole Torah or just a part of Torah? We don't know, right?
Where do we get this information that Torah came on sixth night and Suhufi Ibrahim
Al-Kafi,
came on
fresh? Al-Kafi. It's Al-Kafi. I inshallah, if I remember too, I'll give you exact reference. But I had just in my, sometimes, you know, because of lack of time, especially month of Ramadan, what we do when we prepare, we just use our past notes, right? As we, for example, we have been to Hausa, right? So when we go to Hausa, certain things we learn from our teachers, we just take notes, and the concept is not there at every time you tell your teacher, give us the reference. But then sometimes, of course, when I do presentation, I take the pain to go and find the references. But it is then Kafi, if you just try to, the whole Kafi is online. So if you just put this, for example, Zabur or Injil, if you just try to put on, you may get the reference now.
Kafi is the book of Hadith?
Yes. Al-Kafi, Surah Al-Kafi, yes. It's the most important books of Hadith for Shias.
Okay.
Yeah, it has 8 volumes, and this is. But if I get chance by tomorrow, I'll try to get the exact reference. But it's there. If you just just Google, if you go to a Hadith database on the Academy of Islam, we have a Hadith database. If you just Google, for example, search Zabur, or you might get it. No.
Because the Sunni scholars, they say Quran revealed on 26th night of Ramadan, so if I have to.
27th, yeah. Shabbat Qadr, right?
Yeah.
27th, yeah. Yeah, there is a, yeah, they have this Shabbat Qadr discussion 27th. If I get a chance, I may discuss about it, but he said we have limited time, right? It's a discussion and so on. Yeah.
Okay, two or three more questions. A couple of them are a little bit off topic, but let's try our luck here. One is, Sheikh, are you aware of any versions of Torah or and Zabur in English, and any similarity to Quran?
Yes, of course. Torah is the Old Testament, right? So part of the Old Testament and part of the New Testament is Torah and Injil, but not everything, right? Because we believe that things will change. The collection of this Old Testament, if you see, according to Mark and Luke and all this thing, this is these people who, disciples of Jesus, they try to remember what happened to Jesus. But that was many years after that. No? So that is why certain things you find in the Bible today, same as what we find in the Quran, is because, of course, the source is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But no, not everything. But yes, of course, the Old Testament is part of Torah.
Sheikh, do you have any tips or suggestions on how to help children get rid of the habit of telling lies?
Subhanallah. You know, just now, because we have limited time, I'll tell you one thing, that children tell lie because they have been gifted or they've been rewarded for that. No? Human beings usually do something which is not right, and they do it because they've been rewarded. How? Let me give you an example. But this is the only thing I'm going to say because there's not much time. It's a discussion on its own. If a child goes to school and then his teacher asks, why you didn't do homework? And then, for example, the child says that, no, last night there was no light. I did not have light at home, right? And the teacher says, oh, sorry about that. No, in that case, you are excused, right? We are very sorry about that. I hope that, no, you are okay. You're able to sleep well, right? Not only that the teacher is not angry on him, but the teacher is consoling him, right? So what has happened? The child has lied, and that lie has been rewarded. So then he will lie more. No. So keep in mind that this is the route how children start learning. So, but it's a discussion on its own. It's a discussion on its own. You should talk to people who are experts in raising children. There are a lot of good books, mashallah, with Islamic scholars on raising children. But yes, lying is very bad. And when a child sees that lying is being rewarded, they'll do lie more, right? They say, oh, I can get away with it.
A little bit over time, but if anyone has a question, just unmute yourself. I know we've been taking questions mostly from the chat. Okay.
Assalamu alaikum. I know we're out of time, but if you can answer today or maybe tomorrow, that'll be fine. But it's a little off topic. And I wanted to know about the two namazes for the parents. There's namaz-e maghfirat-e walidain or namaz-e walidain. And I'm a little confused on that because I know one of the namaz I've been told that you do, alham and inna anzalna and alham and surah Kawthar, right? Inna atayna kal Kawthar. So I didn't know. And then there's another namaz where you do khunut and you read 10 times. So I'm confused between the two namaz, and is it required to read between Maghrib and Isha, or could it be read anytime?
I think we answered this thing earlier. Maybe I don't know if you need a time.
Yes, like in the earlier. Yes,
so can you, these things are there. All these are recorded. The past are there. All our sessions from day one are there on Jamaat website. Also, okay. If it was recently, because recently we also started putting YouTube. But very brief is that one is what you said, inna anzalna, inna atayna ka kawthar. It is namadi hadi mayyat. It's not about maghfirat of parents. Namadi hadi mayyat. It can be recited for any marhum, right?
Okay.
And the other one you are saying, ten times the dua and kunut, that is namadi hadi walidain, which can be recited any time. Of course, the best time is after namaz, but any time.
And hadi mayyat should be recited between.
Again, there is no time because hadi mayyat is, for example, when somebody has died. So right. That evening, if you can just recite, they'll be fine.
Okay. Thank you.
One or two more questions in the chat. I don't know if you want to continue to now, or if Sheikh, if you want to hold till tomorrow, we can do it now.
Just catching just fine. It's holiday here, at least in Canada, it's holiday. Go ahead.
Okay, good. This is, again, maybe a little bit off topic. The question is who are the followers of Nabi Dawood?
Yeah, Nabi Dawood, of course, as you know, that Israel considered David, right? You can see the star of the David. So I believe that perhaps Banu Israel were also the followers of Nabi Dawood.
Yeah. And I think similar, maybe a little bit related question here is, how many years were there between Prophet Yusuf and Prophet Musa?
I don't know how to check it, honest.
Yeah, understand. And then the other question is reference to Surah An-Naml. Nabi Ibrahim is defined as Hanif, upright, believer in one God, but Prophet is referred to as first Muslim. So, but weren't all the prophets Muslims?
Yeah, these are questions with tafsir, right? That's required, but yeah, Nabi Ibrahim, of course, upright because Nabi Ibrahim was the one who fought for Tawheed, right? Awwal Muslim doesn't mean only, Awwal Muslim literally is translated as first Muslim, but does not mean the Awwal Muslim, this Muslim, no. It means he was first to believe that, no, or to accept that, no. on Awwal Muslimin, for example, we also recite this dua before Iqamah, right? On Awwal Muslimin. So it's not that I'm the first Muslim. It's like, no, you give priority. Certain words in Arabic are such that it are very rich. Arabic, the beauty of Arabic, and especially Quranic Arabic, is very rich. You just cannot take the meaning appearing in the translation as the meaning. Now, subhanAllah, there are so many meanings. So we also say in after Iqama Awwal Muslimin doesn't mean that we are the first Muslim, as we know we are not, right? So it's a discussion on its own. It requires some in-depth discussion about tafsir, you know.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else have a question? Just come off mute. There's no more in the chat at the moment.
Inshallah, see you tomorrow. Please remember each other in du'as, especially those who are suffering because of the coronavirus. Just pray for mu'mineen that may Allah free them of their this difficulty, whether they are suffering on account of medical suffering or economical or social or mental. May Allah relieve them of the difficulty. Wassalli ala Muhammad wa alihi tahirin. Allahumma salli ala
Muhammad wa ali Muhammad Hassan. Thank you, Sheikh Kudaf, everyone. Hope to see you all tomorrow, same time, 4:30 a.m. Eastern Time. Take care, Kudafis.